clean this. All right. Come on. Oh, come on, y'all. Don't get scared. Please, I need y'all to start reading before y'all get on here, too. I need y'all to start reading and see what the content is about. And then it's going to switch up. It's going to switch up in a second, okay? Come on.
What'd you take it so long for, Sabira?
Because this is my house. So come on, I gotta fix my mic on Instagram. So come on, y'all, let's go. Fix my mic on Instagram so y'all can hear it loud and clear. Again, I'm just getting up, getting myself together. But you are such a scary dude. I'm not scary, sis. Why am I? What makes me scary? I'm humble than a mug. You already know that. What makes me scary? Truth? Come on. I'm just tweeting out, y'all, so that never mind me. Never mind me. Y'all ain't ready yet. I don't think they're ready yet, Diane. I don't think y'all ready yet. Y'all have Twitter? Tweet this out. I don't think y'all ready yet. Let's see if everybody's ready. I gotta get okay if y'all ready. Can we get some likes up before we start this? Don't believe anything I'm saying. Research everything I'm saying. So please share and please let's get the likes up right now. Let's get the likes up and the shares out. Okay? And research everything that I am saying. And always, always, please, people, support. Support the real. okay? Donate, whatever you choose to, okay? So, I guess that one didn't work. Let's try this one. Our people be on CP time. So let's get this thing started, y'all. But Twitter. All right, so we're going to do the ritual thing, people. Okay? Come on, let's share it out. Come on, if you have Twitter, please tweet this out on Twitter. My Twitter is Real Sabir Bey. Yo, where's the share button? I don't know. You just go on YouTube. Let me help you out. Yeah. You don't know what that is? So let me help y'all out how you do this. So there's a share button on YouTube that you click on YouTube and you share. I haven't eaten dinner yet. You hit the share button right there. You go to YouTube and please leave a beautiful comment. Okay. Let's go.
Civil rights, abolitionist movement. Civil rights movement.
Not talking about no Lodi Old Law, baby. Stay focused. Read the title. Please don't come on my feet talking about no Lodi Old nothing, okay? Pay attention to the title. And when I want to go there, I'll go there, okay? Let's go back.
Civil rights, abolitionist movement. Civil rights movement. Anti-war.
Coming straight off the block, we them teachers. We always making that dough on the hustle. This is the style of anthem, throw your hands up. If you a soldier, throw your hands up. Coming straight off the block, we them teachers. Always making that dough on the hustle. This is the style of anthem, throw your hands up. If you a soldier, throw your hands up.
Don't never stop talking about Malcolm X.
Dough on the hustle.
I don't think y'all heard that.
Civil rights.
Y'all ain't hear that.
Abolitionist movement. Civil rights movement. Anti-war.
Coming straight off the block, we them teachers. We always making that dough on the hustle. This is the style of anthem, throw your hands up. If you a soldier, throw your hands up. Coming straight off the block, we them teachers. Always making that dough on the hustle. This is the style of anthem, throw your hands up. If you a soldier, throw your hands up.
I'll never stop talking about Malcolm X. And I'll never stop talking about having safe sex. I'll never stop shouting out Mark. It's Garvey or Kwame Ture or Robert Marley. I'll never eat supper red, black, and green. But teaching what Martin Luther King's dream means. Self-esteem, self-creation. Make yourself, man, you in a wealthy nation. Forget inflation, you are your own mason. Build yourself, set your foundation. Knowledge reigns supreme. That's why when you hear KRS, you know what it means. Stand up.
Coming straight off the block, we don't teach us. Making that dough on the hustle. This is the style of anthem, throw your hands up. If you a soldier, throw your hands up. Coming straight off the block, we them teachers. always making that dough on my watch. This is a scholar, and I'll throw your hands up.
Come on,
if you a soldier, throw your hands up.
Oh. I'll never stop showing the love, man. I'll never stop hanging up pictures of Harriet Tubman. I'll always be a learner, like Nat Turner, spitting out words to take your mind further. Anytime you see my face, you see a peace, love, unity all in this place. When in Rome, it's down. Crime is up, and if you can't hold your ground, your time is up. You see my face, you see a peace, love, unity all in this place. When in Rome, it's down. Crime is up, and if you can't hold your ground, your time is up. But if you don't know your ground, you holding what? Assumptions. When the storm hits you straight out of luck, feeling like you crashed your truck. That's when the teacher shows up. Stand up,
come
up.
Straight off the block, we the teachers. Always making that dough. This is a scholar, and I'm
throw your hands up.
If you a soldier,
throw your hands up.
Come straight off the block, we the teachers. Always making that dough. Oh, this is a scholar, and I'm
throw your hands up.
If you a soldier,
throw your hands up, oh. Where my scholars at? Y'all can holler back. Knowledge and overstanding, we on top of that. We show you right where the commas and them dollars at. We hanging out where them educated mamas at. Follow that. Where my educated papas at? We in the street too, moving when it's time to act. We them teachers, tell me where your mind is at. Fear, doubt, no, we do not follow that. Fat, courage, man, we need to bottle that. Cause all these kids nowadays hear a lot of crap. And they feeling like they gotta follow that. That's why the teacher is bringing the scholar back. Courage, man, we need to bottle that. Cause all these kids nowadays hear a lot of crap. And they feeling like they gotta follow that. That's why the teacher is bringing the scholar back.
Coming straight up the block, we need them teachers. Always making that dough. This is a scholar, and throw your hands up. If you a soldier, throw your hands up. Coming straight up the block, we need them teachers. Always making that dough. All around here, this is a scholar, and throw your hands up. If you a soldier,
throw your hands up.
Pop-Tarts Toaster.
Yo, I love this. Shout out to my brother, Tony B. Tony B. Conscious gave me a jacket yesterday in the Merck Park of the Pioneers of Hip Hop. He's back up in the Bay Area. So you see my brother, Tony B., holler at my dude, you know? So why am I doing this before we start? Okay? Please like, share, and support. So y'all see that there, right? And I, you know, people be paying so much for a research team. I wish they would pay me for research. I'm down to get on somebody's research team if they want to pay me. I'm a hell of a researcher. I got so much, not from Google research, real research. Brother, we're not talking about no American Moors, brother. Stop it. I'm not talking about nothing pertaining to American Moor, okay? Yet. And it's pronounced Philistine, not Palestine. It's pronounced Philistine. So I'm going to play something because I was sent the video, and I've been getting sent all kinds of videos. And I'm going to tell y'all something. This is weird. What up, my brother Jar? Somebody need to go get this dude. This is why I said if we really back real researchers, maybe we can get some stuff done. But I don't know what people be wanting from me, B. Because I don't know. I don't even know half the time. But I'm going to show y'all something. I'm going to address this issue later on after I talk about this guy. But I was sent something about this dude with some misinformation about the Moors. And I know there's a lot of misinformation floating around about the Moors. This brother never cited no sources at all. He just went off and just talked. Listen.
And they're actually the Minoy women, right? Or the Minoy tribe.
Hold up. I can't make this up. Somebody get your boy.
The Minoy tribe. The Alawite dynasty, the Ottoman Algerian Empire, the Egyptian Trans-Saharan slave trade, the Alada Kinamburu Empire, and the remote Moroccan Empire, right? are all countries or empires of Arab conquest, right? It initially started, right, when Arabs and other Europeans or whatever couldn't conquer us in actual physical war. What they did was they would camp outside of the town, kidnap black women, African black women, right? Impregnate them, have the baby, strip them from the culture, teach them ways of the father, and send them back in to Islamicize the entire goddamn
land.
Where
is this new evidence at?
They were Islamicized, they captured the trade routes, collapsed the trade routes, creating famine and destruction inside of villages, in a sense destroying it from the inside out. Once they were destroyed, Islam spread over the entire goddamn spans of all of those empires and dynasties that you name, right? Once they did this, it was through Arab conquest that we started to see these people start to identify as Moor, as they were in Morocco. A Moor isn't really distinguished as a black Moor or a black Moor or Arab Moor, because they ain't going to respond to any of y'all, right?
Somebody need to kiss this dude, man. They need to get with him. Listen.
The exception of the Dahomey tribe, and Dahomey is absolutely a name of European.
We're talking about these Arabs.
The Minoy women, right, or the Minoy tribe. The Alawite dynasty, the Ottoman Algerian Empire, the Egyptian Trans-Saharan slave trade, the Alada Kinamburu Empire, and the Moroccan Empire, right, are all countries or empires of Arab conquest, right? It initially started, right, when Arabs and other Europeans or whatever couldn't conquer us in actual physical war. What they did was they would camp outside of the town, kidnap black women, African black women, right? Impregnate them, have the baby, strip them from the culture, teach them ways of the father, and send them back in to Islamicize the entire goddamn land, right? Once they were Islamicized, they captured the trade routes, collapsed the trade routes, creating famine and destruction inside of villages, in a sense destroying it from the inside out. Once they were destroyed, Islam spread over the entire goddamn.
Where did this guy get this information from?
Empires and dynasties that you name, right? Once they did this, it was through Arab conquest that we started to see these people start to identify as Moor, as they were in Morocco. A Moor isn't really distinguished as a black Moor or a black Moor or Arab Moor, because they don't want to respond to any of
them. I can't make this. Yo, I'm going to keep it real with y'all. Some of these dudes just need to not do videos. A lot of these dudes just need to fall back, get your study on for a couple of years, do some traveling, and then come back and try to tell people. So if y'all know who this brother is, tell him I'm on a live right now. That's embarrassing. That's totally embarrassing. Tell him to come to the Sabir Bay show. That's kind of crazy, yo. Cuckoo. So instead of us, yeah, it is funny shit, Madib. Think of my brother, Madib. Madib. These cats have no freaking idea, brother. They have no idea of what they're talking about. It's all the money that people spend on research, right? Because even down to the Nation of Islam has a research team. How about the Nation of Islam hire me as a researcher? I ain't even got to do the research no more. I can actually give them all the information that they need. But I just had to play that because that was the funniest thing ever when that dude said that. I could not believe he said that. I would ask him, where's his information at? Where's his sources at? Where did he get it from? Bring his teachers over here. I've been hearing a lot of misinformation about the Moors. I told y'all to come over here if y'all want to hear about the Moors. I can listen. I told y'all I can go to any state. I'll be in Atlanta this week. I ain't telling y'all what day, but I will be in Atlanta this week. And we're working on Denver, Colorado. I'm just waiting for my brother Jeff. So let me do this. Home obviously stuck on color coding. He needs more scholarship. You ain't never lie about that, brother, because hopefully somebody know that dude and share this video to him and tell him to come over here. I guarantee he won't come. So all of these things that these dudes is talking about, what they're doing is pulling images off of social media. Images off of social media. But I'm going to show you what real research is. What up, brother Romeo?
What's up, fam?
Chilling. Chilling. Is that my brother Blunty? So I ain't start yet, Blunty. That's why I was telling people I want people to come on and share this out, because what happens, y'all gonna come on my feed late and think I'm attacking somebody and not realizing that I was on here for like a good 30 minutes before you even thought about it. So come on and share this out. And while we sharing this out, I'm gonna do this because I'm still waiting for people to come on. I'm still waiting for more people.
So nice to me.
So I don't want nobody missing anything. So my links is up here for anybody to come on. Okay, so
yeah, we live this. Wait, kind of hard sometimes, trying to help those who diss you at the same time. But it's
kind of hard sometimes to help those that try to diss you at the same time. God damn.
We live this.
Come on, share this out.
It gets kind of hard sometimes, trying to help those who diss you at the same time. But it's the life.
Come on, let's go.
Still going to be
way more people. Come on.
For the hood, rise up, y'all.
Why y'all keep shitting on me? On the internet, cats think they spitting on me. But if you read they shit, they be real corny. For my downfall, they get real horny. All I'm trying to do is educate the young ones. I got some guns, but we ain't no dum-dums. Yo, come, son, let me show you the way out. Knowledge reigns supreme, we never play out or fade out. This a lifetime thing. You in darkness, heartless, complaining about the light I bring. Well, stay there then. I guess you ain't my friend, but remember, hip-hop, it ain't gonna end. And there in the future, we gonna see who really was the slave and who was free? Who sold out the culture to be on TV? And there in the future, we gonna see who really was the slave and who was free? Who sold out the culture to be on TV? Nah, it won't be me. Rappers wanna stop me, pop me, drop me, knock me, knock me, top me, but they really up to no good.
What's wrong?
Critics wanna hit me, get me, clip me, rip me, strip me, trick me, but they really up to no good.
What's wrong?
Players wanna slap me, cap me, trap me, out tap me, out rap me, but they really up to no good.
What's wrong?
Others wanna rush me, dust me, bust me, lust me, cuss me, hush me, but they really up to no good.
Come on, man.
Now some of y'all bugging, cause I am hip hop, but you are too. You just can't get that. As a man thinking, so is he. I am hip hop, and so are we. And so is she, and so is he. I'm the only one teaching, and you wanna diss me. Why? Am I really that important? Are you so desperate? Any life you'll shorten. Well, nah, kid. I'ma live on and on. You're gonna respect me now and not when I'm gone. I see how y'all did JMJ. He paid your way, but all you wanna get is your pay. I always be the knowledge giver, preachy, uneasy. Yo, take your 30 pieces of silver and hang yourself by the end of this verse. But remember, the last shall be first. Rappers wanna stop me, pop me, drop me, knock me, knock me,
stop me,
but they really up to no good.
What's your plan?
Critics wanna hit me, get me, clip me, rip me, strip me, trick me, but they really up to no good.
What's your plan?
Players wanna slap me, cap me, trap me, out tap me, out rap me, but they really up to no good.
What's your plan?
Others wanna rush me, dust me, bust me, lust me, cuss me, hush me, but they really up to no good.
Come on, man.
Chris loves hip hop, everybody knows that. We came out of poverty and we ain't going back. A 60 cent royalty, don't settle for that. You'll do what you gotta, but don't remain in the trap. We all crying out for leadership. But if the leader steps up and you diss him, what we gonna get? You? You ain't even got a better plan. You can't even take hip hop to a better land. You yourself ain't even a better man. Look who follows you. KRS even got better fans. Sure, you get grands, and that's all good. But your video shows that you sold your manhood. So are you really eligible to challenge me? Especially you writers that never made a CD. Especially you DJs that get shit for free. You can't play Kane or PE.
Ooh, I think they tried. Let's make sure I'm good on Instagram. We good on Instagram because I had a bunch of people on Instagram, and I don't know what just happened, but I think the title is upsetting somebody. I think that title is upsetting somebody. Let me know if we good on Instagram, yo, because we got a lot of people here, but it's not showing it anymore. Come on, y'all. We good on Instagram. If not, the hell with Instagram and come over to YouTube.
Come I heard to the ADL big mad.
Who cares if they mad? Truth is the truth. But this is the crazy part. Let me say this. The views and opinions on the Sabir Bay Show is not necessarily the views and opinions of the people I'm going to play.
Right.
I don't own the rights to this, brother, but I do have to play this. I'm going to see if I can play a little bit of this so y'all can understand where I'm going at with this, because this is a very hard thing. And I'm trying to be careful about what I'm saying, but not necessarily careful, because I know y'all ain't got my back for telling the truth. That's just the reality. Right. So what's up, Stan? So I'm going to play something for y'all, because first I want y'all to see something.
Peace, bro.
I got a book yesterday when I was at the bookstore. This book. And a lot of this stuff inside here is why the ADL is where they at now. Hmm. And it's weird, because I was listening to one of the books, and I don't like the whole black thing. You know what I mean? I'm weird about the black thing, but
right.
It's the relationship between the blacks and Jews, right? So it was the third one. So I'm going to play this, even though on the rights of this, but if they listen to me, I'm letting y'all know up front. If they block this video, even if I said what I said, it's saved on StreamYard. So don't worry about it. It's saved on StreamYard. Everything is saved on StreamYard. Even if they cut me on Instagram, cut me on YouTube, it's on StreamYard. So email me at knowledgeversus@gmail.com. I will be in ATL this week. Do not believe anything I'm saying to you. Research everything I'm saying. Okay? So I'm going to just show you something real quick. So I showed y'all Palestine, but check this out, right? All these people ask for donations. Donate. This was a newspaper. We'll get into him later on. This was in Michigan. So y'all can donate also for the information. And I'm going to go on and on and on with this, but I picked this book up, and I was reading it last night. And how many of y'all ever heard of Leo Frank? Leo Frank. Come on, y'all. Come on. How many people heard of Leo Frank?
Nah, don't ring no bell.
Everybody should know about it, though, but this is the crazy part. They should know about it. There it is right there inside the book. This is not Wikipedia. This is inside the book I have. The lynching of Leo Frank in 1915. He was a Jew.
Wow.
That raped a 13-year-old girl. So the reason why I'm saying this, because, and again, I have to be very careful. See, this is quiet in history, though. This is very quiet, but you will show all of our people being hung, right? All of our people being hung at this particular time. But do you see any Jew running around here talking about this?
Not at all.
None of them, right? So as I was reading his book on him, he raped this little, accused of raping this 13-year-old girl, because you know they had underage people working in factories at that time.
Yeah, right.
And they still doing it to this day. He was the head of
Somebody got caught. Oh, my bad. Go ahead.
Well, go ahead. No, go.
Oh no, because I think like in China or somewhere, some teenagers got caught in a factory, like working in some harsh conditions, like recently, yo.
But it's
I want to say the cross season somewhere. So yeah.
But it's still going on. It's still going on to this day.
Thanks.
Still, to this day, it's still going on, right? So I'm going to share something with you, and I'm going to play this video. Give me one second. Right? Now, y'all may have, you know, read The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews and da-da-da-da-da, right? So I was reading this book last night, and I ran across a lot that was in it, but you don't never hear Jews talking about this. Not at all. Not at all. At all. Right? So he tried to blame it on brothers. And as I'm reading this whole story, and I'm reading other stories, you have no idea. Let me tell you something.
Wow.
I was reading something.
Imitating. Oh, my God.
you ain't hear nothing yet. As I'm pulling all these different books out, like, remember that time I told you that they always said they would get a good Negro, like Stephen A. Smith Negroes? This is why we ain't getting nothing done.
Yeah, the go along, get along people.
Right? So what happened? It talks about that. It talks about those Negroes that did not rebel. I got a book right there. It's called Slavery in America. And it talks about those people that did not rebel. They gave the position to. Do y'all want to know why we are being betrayed by our own people? Because you have these people in certain positions that know, right? We have all these scholars that pay for research teams. People who do research get paid like $60,000, $70,000. I don't know if you know that or not. They get paid a lot. So all of this is happening, right? I'm saying, how is it that we don't have a research team to find out who we were before 1500s? Where is the research team that are the people that we can pay to do the research? You can pay me now because I can give you all the research.
Facts.
I ain't even got to do the research. It's there, right? For multiple sources, right? So they said the ones that did not rebel, they gave the positions to. And as I'm, y'all going to hear a little bit of it, but that is, if you actually read this book too, you're going to hear it in this lady speaking on it also. But if you read this book, it's in here too. And if you ever read, give me one second, if you ever saw this movie, 12 Years a Slave, and I compare this to 12 years of going to school. 12 years of high, 12 years of school, right? And then three to four more years of brainwashing camp in universities. In this, if you see this movie, 12 Years a Slave, in the scene in the movie, he got drunk sitting with two Europeans. He thought he was made. I'm free. I'm going to drink with them. Right? And they made him a slave the next day. So when they're done with you, they're done with you. But we not having real people that back real people and support right. The people who's not swindling you or not trying to chase the bag. So all of this is happening. So this book is coming up, Leo Frank. Before the Mayflower is coming up, 12 Years a Slave. So all this is in my head. I'm like, God damn, it's like full circle with this mug, bro. And if you want to know why we have all these so-called black people in certain positions, it's because they're the submissive Negroes. They are the submissive ones. They're going to give them jobs. And then I'm going to play something for y'all. Again, I don't own the rights to this. Remember what I told y'all. The ADL might get mad at this. The Jews may get mad at this. But they don't put their dirty laundry out here like that. They keep it quiet. So Leo Frank was accused of raping a 13-year-old girl. Yeah, y'all should be in an uproar with this motherfucker. 1915, he was lynched. Taken out to jail. And lynched. It was in Atlanta. Matter of fact, when I get to Atlanta, I might go there. I might go to the plaque. It's a plaque. Oh, you think I'm playing? Oh, you think I'm playing? Hold up. I'm going to show you. Oh, it's a plaque, brother. Give me one second.
You go knocking on some doors.
Hold up. It's a plaque. Give me one second. It's definitely a plaque down there. Let me see if I can pull it up real fast.
Yeah, they definitely think they slick.
So here, I'm going to show you the plaque. Hold up. That's not it. That's not it. What song was that? Who sang that in a hip-hop song? That's not it. Salt and Pepper, man. Come on, man. Take you too long.
Salt and Pepper.
What's it? That's not... Come on, B. I know I got it in here somewhere. So there's a plaque with him up there. Give me one second. And what it is on the plaque, I think the Leo Frank case lynching, everything you know about, okay.
Would it, the ADL gave him a plaque?
No, they just, you know, when somebody dies somewhere, they give you a plaque. I mean, they tell him where he...
A memorial?
Yeah. Hold up, man. I know I just had this goddamn thing, man.
What was his name?
Hold up.
Mary Fagan.
Yeah, give me one second, bro. Let me see. I gotta find it. Give me one second. I hate when I do this, man. Now this, I thought I'd put that up there too. Oh, Margaret said, let's go. Yeah, Margaret, we're going to go, okay? When I get that, we're going to definitely go. But if you look it up, you can find the plaque.
Investigating in Atlanta.
Found it?
Nah. I was just thinking about you out there in Atlanta investigating the case, man.
Hold up. Yeah, I'm going to pull it up in a minute. So, yeah, I'm going to go there. Where was he taken from? He was taken out of the prison. Give me 1 second. And taken and hung because he got his neck cut, throat cut before that, but he survived. So here you go right here. I'm going to give y'all the case, okay? Damn, bro, you got to get up on your game, brother. When I throw stuff at you, you supposed to know how to research these things, brother. You got to know how to fast research these things. There you go, Leo Frank, a Jewish man in Atlanta, was placed on trial, convicted of rape and murder, a 13-year-old girl who worked at a national pencil company. There it is, right there, right? See, Jews ain't telling y'all about this motherfucker, is they? Georgia Encyclopedia.
Mm-hmm.
So, murder, here she go, 1913 when it happened, here she go. Oh no, they not going to talk about this.
Mm-mm.
They said he was kidnapped from prison.
Yes, he was. But don't worry about it, Matt. You're going to see me in Atlanta. I don't need to let you know. You ain't sponsored me to come to Atlanta, so when you see me pop up there, don't worry about it. You're going to know definitely I'm live.
When you see me.
You know what I mean? See me when you see me, B. You ain't put up no money for me to come there. Don't worry about when I get there. I'm definitely going to be there. So there you go, right? That's what you saw inside the book. So wait a minute. Let's go down further. Let me show you the plaque. There it is, right there. The governor's decision of Atlanta. So I'm going to go there.
Why it says here he was pardoned?
No, they was trying. I'm going to get into the whole story behind that. Oh, Jews put up money to cover up everything, just like they do Negroes. Listen, all these people will put up so much money to cover up the truth.
Yeah, that's what, man, that's that propaganda, bro. Man, that's so deep.
That's the propaganda.
Hey, like what you said, that's what sparked the ADL right here.
There
this
you
case.
Go. That's what sparked
they
the ADL.
They paid so much money to cover up all this.
Listen to this. Here's another
one. Beer's on the case now.
But the banks are close, man.
Look at what they said again. Remember I told y'all, choose an amount, y'all. If y'all want to donate, $3, $100, $25, whatever. You see that? This is what they do. But yet, I'm giving it to you so y'all can donate. Let's go. To me. Let's play this.
The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews. Volume 3. The Leo Frank Case. The Lynching of a Guilty Man. Prepared by the Historical Research Department of the Nation of Islam, Chicago, Illinois. Copyright 2016 by Latimer Associates. All rights reserved. Published in audiobook form by the American Mercury with permission of the Nation of Islam. Quote, let us have the truth in this case, and that speedily. Let us play with all the cards on the table, for the issue involves human life. Let the detectives get right, lest they fall themselves into the grave which they have dug for another. For truth is on the march, and all things hidden will come to light. End quote. Leo M. Frank. Preface to the Secret Relationship series. Quote, we have no documentable evidence of anti-Semitism on the part of the Temples of Islam movement or Elijah Muhammad. End quote. Arnold Forster, Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith. In 1991, The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, National Representative of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Nation of Islam, NOI, released the first of several volumes in the scholarly series titled The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews. This research was prepared by the NOI's Historical Research Department in response to the written by prominent Jewish, the leading traders in America's cotton economy. The American labor movement is shown to have had deep Jewish roots and a devastating long-term effect on Black economic progress. The Ku Klux Klan and other white terrorist groups were the premier enforcers of white supremacy and had Jewish involvement at every level, as supporters, members, and financiers. The first two volumes of The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews contain nearly 1,000 pages of research that uncovers a history of oppression Jews had successfully kept hidden from view. The present third volume in the series, The Leo Frank Case, The Lynching of a Guilty Man, examines a tragic incident largely unknown to most American Blacks, but reverentially regarded by American Jews. That incident occurred in Atlanta, Georgia, between 1913 and 1915, and involved a B'nai B'rith leader and factory manager named Leo Max Frank. He was tried and convicted of murdering a 13-year-old Gentile girl and sentenced to die. An unknown posse stormed the prison and lynched him, making Frank reputedly the only Jew ever lynched in America. The case became an international cause célèbre for Jews, most of whom believed Frank was the victim of anti-Semitism. Several books and hundreds of articles have been written on the tragedy, which has now become a central pillar of American Jewish identity. For 100 years, Jews have insisted that the Leo Frank case is emblematic of their history of suffering and victimization in America. Moreover, the case so profoundly affected the relationship Blacks had with American Jews that it can be said that before the Leo Frank affair, Jews were the Black man's open enemy. After the Leo Frank affair, Jews were the Black man's best friend.
Woo!
Indeed, the Leo Frank case is that pivotal point in Black history when the Jews' history of slave trading, ownership of cotton, sugar, and tobacco plantations, Ku Klux Klan terrorism, and Jim Crow apartheid.
How many of y'all knew that?
A new narrative of shared persecution, civil rights coalition, and political common cause. Consequently, an honest assessment of the Black-Jewish relationship must include a comprehensive examination of the Leo Frank case and its profound effect on both Black.
You can book me to come to Las Vegas. I'm open for that. Okay, I'm open. Email me.
The Jewish demand that scholars focus on the Leo Frank case history leads to an unanticipated treasure trove of unexplored records and documents that unlock the most confidential operations of the Jews' highest leadership circles. As the Jewish people united in the international fight to overturn Leo Frank's murder conviction, considerable data about their activities leaked into the public record. Information so extensive and so revealing that its very existence is unique in the annals of Jewish history. The Leo Frank case offers a unique window into the thinking and strategizing of the leaders of the Jewish people.
That part.
Leo Frank was not of the rank and file Jewish citizenry. As the president of the Atlanta chapter of the fraternal order B'nai B'rith, he was arguably the most important Jew in the South.
Oh my God.
Jews considered him as having, in effect, diplomatic immunity within the white rulership of the Jim Crow South. So his arrest, trial, and conviction shocked, offended, and activated Jews at the highest level.
Who?
White Gentiles and Jews had been intimate partners in Dixie's slavery system, from which they both derived vast riches. They had freely intermingled in the social, political, and economic culture of the White South, but the Leo Frank trial and conviction set up a showdown like no other in Gentile Jewish history.
Why y'all know about this case?
All the major Jewish leaders in banking, media, clergy, law, business, and politics mounted a massive operation to free Leo Frank. And the racial ruthlessness of their efforts is laid bare through a massive cache of documents, including personal letters, rabbinical sermons, official reports, interview transcripts, legal filings, and newspaper reports.
You see how that works with them?
They tell a sordid tale of purchased testimony, the planting of evidence, racial scapegoating, extreme expressions of racism, financial manipulations, bribery, retaliation, threats to witnesses, and even attempted murder.
You can't get mad at these people.
The case is further marred by the academic world's willful concealment of this damning evidence, a deception that continues to this very moment. From the trial of Leo Frank in 1913 to his lynching 2 years later, records reveal a methodology only hinted at and speculated on by such purportedly anti-Semitic texts as the Protocols of the Learned Elders of Zion,
this is what
Henry
ABL
Thoreau's International
from.
Jew, and Martin Luther's The Jews and Their Lies, all of whose theses were undermined not only by an often conspiratorial and outside-looking-in perspective, but also by their lack of documentation and specificity. No other example exists that so publicly pitted Jews and Gentiles in a test of wills like the Leo Frank case. And Jews practically demand that the outside world investigate the case to draw an accurate portrait of the American Jewish identity, how they have suffered and overcome racial and religious persecution. In 2015, Jonathan Greenblatt, the newly appointed national director of the Anti-Defamation League, chose the 100th anniversary of Frank's lynching, August 17, 1915, to announce a major national initiative against anti-Semitism. And in his remarks, Greenblatt invoked the name of Leo Frank multiple times. Without question, the case is the central pillar of Jewish American identity.
Did they hear them talking about that?
As we take a microscope to this little known but highly significant event in Black Jewish history, we first examine the essential details of the crime, seeking the truth as to who really killed Mary Fagan. Next, we unwrap this mystery in such detail that new and powerful truths are revealed that upset the standard narrative. And then we expose the untold story of the Jewish fight to free a B'nai B'rit leader who tried to get away with murder.
Yo, dude, they stick together.
Introduction.
Like a mug, bro.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. End quote. Martin Luther King Jr., inspired by 19th century minister Theodore Parker.
Come on, let's share this out. Let's
quote. What happened to Mary Fagan was terrible.
13 years
what old. Happened to Leo Frank was even more terrible. End quote. Harry Golden. In 1913, Jim Crow, Georgia, a wealthy and powerful white man was charged with the brutal rape and murder of his employee, a 13-year-old white girl. He vehemently denied the charge and accused two of his black employees of the crime. He had the finest lawyers in the South and two of the nation's most expensive private detective firms at his disposal. The governor of the state of Georgia resolutely supported him, and the world's most important newspaper vigorously backed him.
Do you know what they were doing? They know what they set all this stuff up, B. They
are by a mob of fellow white men, and the black men went free. That outcome is unique in American racial history. And so we begin that incredible story.
Yes, you can book me.
These facts are indisputable. On August 25th, 1913, Leo Max Frank, the Jewish manager of an Atlanta pencil factory and president of the local chapter of the Jewish fraternal organization, B'nai B'rith, was found guilty by a Georgia jury and sentenced to death by hanging for the brutal murder of one of his employees, a 13-year-old white Christian girl named Mary Fagan. For the next 2 years, Frank appealed the guilty verdict 13 separate times, and all the appellate courts, including the United States Supreme Court, upheld the verdict and the death sentence. On June 21st, 1915, a day before Frank was scheduled to hang, Georgia's governor, John M. Slayton, commuted Frank's death sentence to life imprisonment to be served in the state's penitentiary. On August 17th, 1915, more than a dozen men seized Frank from the state prison, drove him to the murdered girl's hometown, and hanged him from a tree.
Well, I just showed you that plaque.
He was one of only three Jews to have ever been lynched in America.
Whew.
And beyond those established facts, all agreement ends. The trial and aftermath made major waves in the American judicial system when the peculiar circumstances of that trial opened a significant fissure in the very foundation of American white supremacy. Blacks had long been barred from participation in any legal proceeding except as defendants, and their testimony, especially in cases involving the fate of white persons, was simply deemed invalid. Despite those hard and fast Jim Crow laws and customs, Leo Frank became the first white man in the South to be convicted of a capital offense in a trial that featured the prominent testimony of black witnesses. That fact alone made the Frank case revolutionary. The trial placed several of Frank's black employees on the witness stand to contradict directly and convincingly the claims of their wealthy white Jewish employer. By its admission of black testimony, the Frank case could easily have been seen as a major advance in the long civil rights struggle of blacks in America and a bellwether of future progress. Jews, however, did not see this judicial reform as a progressive action at all. The unprecedented deviation from the South's racist norms stunned Jews, causing them to reassess their relationship with their fellow Caucasians and to question whether they too had become vulnerable to the iniquities of American Jim Crow, a system which Jews had helped to establish and from which Jews had derived many, many social, political, and especially financial benefits. In fact, most Jews believe that the acceptance of, quote, Negro testimony, end quote, was a most egregious assault on their rights, that the court's validation of blacks as witnesses was the proof that the white Gentiles had turned their backs on them, and that, quote, anti-Semitism, end quote, was responsible for Frank's conviction. Dr. Stuart Rockoff summarized the Jewish point of view. In the South, white defendants were generally protected from the testimony of black witnesses or the judgment of black jurors. Yet Frank did not receive this protection, and he was convicted and ultimately lynched based on the testimony of a black witness.
Listen,
thus, social whiteness for Southern Jews could be provisional and limited. Now? Further fueling this racial bonfire is the aggressive Jewish claim that the actual murderer of the young white Mary Fagan was Frank's own hired janitor, James Jim
Conley. Look at this. Listen to this.
Financial benefits.
Listen.
In fact, most Jews believe that the acceptance of, quote, Negro testimony, end quote, was a most egregious assault on their rights, that the court's validation of blacks as witnesses was the proof that the white Gentiles had turned their backs on them, and that, quote, anti-Semitism, end quote, was responsible for Frank's conviction.
You hear that?
Dr. Stuart Rockoff summarized the Jewish point of view. In the South, white defendants were generally protected from the testimony of black witnesses or the judgment of black jurors. Yet Frank did not receive this protection, and he was convicted and ultimately lynched based on the testimony of a black witness. Thus, social whiteness for Southern Jews could be provisional and limited.
I would have hatred.
Further fueling this racial bonfire is the aggressive Jewish claim that the actual murderer of the young white Mary Fagan was Frank's own hired janitor, James Jim Conley.
He was trying to frame him.
Conley's impressive witness stand testimony was easily the most damaging blow to Frank's trial defense. These dual insults, the tainting of the moral image of a Jewish leader, and the belief that a white Jew paid the ultimate price for the crime of a black man,
can we get these likes
have
up?
Haunted and vexed Frank's Jewish advocates for a century. Blacks are far less familiar with the Leo Frank case, even though it is arguably as important to black progress as Plessy versus Ferguson,
woo,
Brown versus Board,
woo,
or even Lincoln's 1863 Emancipation Proclamation.
Why are we not talking about this then?
The black janitor whose testimony became central to Leo Frank's conviction became the most quoted black person in American history up to that time.
Let's go back.
For the judgment of black jurors. Yet Frank did not receive this protection.
One more time.
He was convicted and ultimately lynched based on the testimony of a black witness.
One more time.
Thus, social whiteness for Southern Jews could be provisional and limited.
One more time. Listen.
Further fueling this racial bonfire is the aggressive Jewish claim that the actual murderer of the young white Mary Fagan was Frank's own hired janitor, James Jim Conley. Conley's impressive witness stand testimony was easily the most damaging blow to Frank's trial defense. these dual insults.
Come on.
The tainting of the moral image of a Jewish leader and the belief that a white Jew paid the ultimate price for the crime of a black man have haunted and vexed Frank's Jewish advocates for a century. Blacks are far less familiar with the Leo Frank case, even though it is arguably as important to black progress as Plessy versus Ferguson, Brown versus Board, or even Lincoln's 1863 Emancipation Proclamation. The black janitor whose testimony became central to Leo Frank's conviction became the most quoted black person in American history up to that time.
Ooh.
More of his words appeared in print in the New York Times than those of W.E.B. Du Bois, Marcus M. Garvey, and Booker T. Washington.
Damn.
Combined.
Whoa. Damn, they say
combined. Most significant, the Leo Frank case influenced critical events in the history of the relationship between blacks and Jews in America. Frank's lynching, quote, became a symbol of Jew hatred in America, end quote,
damn,
and motivated Jews to build alliances with oppressed blacks, resulting in the fabled and controversial Black-Jewish Alliance. The Leo Frank case gave the nascent Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith its raison d'etre. The ADL would become the main representative body of American Jews and the Jewish organization most aggressively involved in black internal affairs. The Leo Frank case was claimed to be the pivotal event that ignited the explosive growth of the terrorist Ku Klux Klan, which mushroomed to the largest size in its history. Incredibly, the Jewish Leo Frank and his multi-ethnic, multi-racial saga are at the root of those signal events in black history. So why has this case become so critically important, even a century after its tragic conclusion? How has the lynching of this particular Jewish man superseded in significance the thousands of black hangings, burnings, and shootings to become the symbol of lynching in America? Why is a scrutiny of this case vital to a true and accurate understanding of racism in America? An objective and unemotional review of this forgotten tragedy will certainly result in pain for some, relief for others, but once the hidden and suppressed truths are uncovered and revealed, all will be enlightened by a fresh analysis of this fateful event in American history. Leo Frank and Mary Fagan.
Wow.
Predator and prey. Quote, it was very hard for us to be fair to him. He impressed us as a sexual pervert. End quote.
That's crazy, bro.
Albert Lasker, Leo Frank's financier. Leo Max Frank was born in 1884 in Quero, Texas, the son of a successful Texas merchant.
Leo Frank.
At 3 months old, his folks moved to New York and raised young Leo in Brooklyn, before he went on to Cornell University and eventually obtained a degree in mechanical engineering. When offered a chance to become the superintendent of his uncle's Atlanta pencil factory in 1908, Leo Frank went south to take the position. Though raised a New Yorker, Frank possessed a legitimate Southern royal heritage. His uncle was a pro-slavery Confederate veteran. It was an honorific distinction that facilitated his acceptance into the aristocracy of Atlanta's elite community of German Jews, the well-established German leaders Jews. Of the Southern business German world. Jews. He Jews soon married the daughter of a prominent Jewish family religion. And moved into his in-law's residence. So quickly did he earn the respect of the Jews of Georgia that they elected him president of the 500-member Atlanta chapter of B'nai B'rith, the leading Jewish fraternal order in America. The National Pencil Company, then located at 37 South Forsyth Street in Atlanta, sat just about where the Sam Nunn Federal Center sits today. In 1913, the factory was part of a larger effort by American industrialists to diversify the Southern economy and expand its base beyond the one crop, cotton, agricultural system that had for nearly three centuries made whites entirely dependent on black slave labor. But that effort sought the modernization of infrastructure without budging from the region's political, economic, and cultural obligations to white racial supremacy. Blacks were still forced to remain at the lowest rung, even as the South pushed forward to grow beyond the plantation. Leo Frank fully embraced that vision and operated his factory by the exploitative methods and practices that emerged from the slavery system.
Listen to this.
Black employees at Frank's pencil factory were paid less, limited to the rudest jobs, and confined to segregated facilities.
Damn, you be on it. Yes,
and they faced corporal punishment if thought to be underperforming.
Yes, I do.
There were white restrooms on the upper floors and a, quote, Negro toilet, end quote, in the basement. Child laborers worked long hours in primitive conditions for minuscule pay, while the enormous profits accrued to the pencil factory's owners.
So come on before they
Anti-Defamation League attorney Dale Schwartz lamented that in Atlanta, quote, there were a lot of sweatshops that employed young teenagers at 10 cents an hour wages, and a lot of them were owned by Jewish people, end quote.
What?
Frank, yo, quote, viewed blacks as fundamentally inferior to himself and other Southern whites, end quote.
Fair use, B.
According to Dr. Stephen A. Brown. He believed, quote, that Southern black society was divided into two distinct groups. Good darkies.
So let me explain this to y'all. Y'all going to hear him say about the good darkies and the light people. You're going to hear all this is going to be explained in here. But what I'm looking at in this whole case, that I'm looking at, like, from 1913, 14, 15, we still doing the exact same thing with Stephen A. Smith, Charles Barkley, all of the good Negroes that they actually got to sit in front of you to tell you something out of all the money that these people have.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have a research team to talk about who we were and what we was called before the 1500s. Think about it. Will Smith have a movie called Emancipation. We don't need to have no more slave movies put out here. But the Jews, as I'm looking at, they will put so much money behind to keep this quiet.
Mm-hmm.
Money to expose each other and expose ourselves every day. Why ain't you hear about this in school? Ephraim said, he said, I'll be going in, huh? I'll be on it, boy. But this is the thing. As I went and got the book, it was weird because I'm in the last bookstore yesterday. And I seen the book. I said, yo, I got to bring this book. I got to buy it, right? I got to buy this book. But when I flipped the page, because I heard the name before, I said, hold up. That's him being lynched. Why are we hearing about the first Jew being lynched in 1913?
Quiet is kept.
Quiet, right? And how about...
they said Anne Frank's.
Listen, they said, and you're going to hear more because it was natural for them to actually molest these girls that was 13, 14 years old. Then it made me think about whatever this thing is. I can't remember that name.
Yeah, you're right.
What they're doing like now. And I said, wait a minute. We talk about R. Kelly, but the motherfucking Jews was doing this and these girls was grown ass girls.
Mm-hmm.
This is the crazy part of what I'm looking at, bro. I'm like, yo, but we would jump on everything like a hole in heat and never question nobody. Mm-hmm. I told y'all before, I've been doing radio for over 20 something years. I don't take sides with nobody, no one at all. I can be on any radio show, whatever it is, and explain to our people, brother. It's this what I'm watching, and I try to pick and choose what I'm going to talk about, how I'm going to talk about it, what I'm going to say, because it offends some of y'all black folks. It does. It really does, because I'm telling you the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody wants the truth.
Nobody wants the truth.
You don't want the truth. Eh?
No.
Only the real ones.
Listen, I'm not getting paid for this. Let's make this clear. So I got to put that out there. So it's just me being a journalist. But they're asking for $100 and customize and make all these things and donate to what they're doing. They're talking about your donation will be matched 2-1. So let's see if we can match it, y'all. Let's go.
Speaking of sex offenders.
Let's do this. Let's see if we can match with y'all. Come on, y'all. Let's go. Hit it. My Cash App and PayPal is right there.
Damn, support. And they hit both of your accounts.
Go. Say that again. Both of my accounts. What?
They spamming with the sex offenders, speaking on the sex offenders.
Exactly. But that happens, brother. That's what's going to happen. But hit it up. Let's support. Let's see if we can match that. Let's match it, y'all, since they're asking for it. 2-1. Let's see how many people support. Let's go back to the audio. Listen up.
Keys, who could be trusted,
donate,
and
y'all.
Right bad there, niggers who could not. End quote. Worse, one of the company's major stockholders, the well-respected Oscar Pappenheimer, had in 1906, the same year in which whites sparked a major Atlanta riot, killing over 50 blacks, promoted Jim Crow legislation targeting all blacks in the South. Quote, I propose that...
I'm doing it right now. You're saying if this was taught, I need y'all help. We need finances to make this stuff work. So let's see if we can hit it up. Come on. They're asking for it. It is being taught. It's being taught right now.
Written now.
It's being taught right now.
It's taught.
The registration of Negroes in the Southern states, 14 years of age and more. Each person so registered should possess.
Listen to this.
A certificate.
Hold up. Watch this.
In which should be entered description, date, and place of birth, and at each registration, who could be trusted, and bad niggers who could not.
Bad end niggers, quote. Niggers that can be trusted.
Worse, one of the company's major stockholders, the well-respected Oscar Pappenheimer, had in 1906, the same year in which whites sparked a major Atlanta riot, killing over 50 blacks, promoted Jim Crow legislation targeting all blacks in the South. Quote, I propose the registration of Negroes in the Southern states, 14 years of age and more. Each person so registered should possess a certificate, in which should be entered description, date, and place of birth, and at each registration, record of abode, employment, conduct, and reference.
Hold up.
These.
Did you hear what he said? What she said? This is what all these Negroes, like the Roland Martins, and I'm talking about Democrat, get them registered. Where you from? What? Listen, what's going on? You mean to tell me we haven't moved since that time frame? Register them. Register the Negroes. Oh man, y'all don't get. What's up, Ephraim? Come on, B. Come on. This is...
Hey, what's up? I'm reading it right now on the New Georgia Encyclopedia. So I'm gonna hit the mute.
Brother, this is insane that they are still doing this, and your black leaders are selling you out, talking about Democrat, Republican, all this nonsense.
Till this day.
The Negroes that can be trusted and the ones that could not be trusted. I guess I'm the one that can't be trusted. I guess I'm the one that can't be trusted. All the other ones that you can put on the fleas. That's why we getting influenced by them. By them. Put him up here. They'll listen. He's not a bad Negro. And this is why I said, you never really see a 100% so-called real brother in no kind of office, even if they're articulate. You will never see a real brother speaking, or a president or a governor. A real brother is people that they train in their school system. And y'all want to talk about the Jews run this, Jews run that. What do you also think they run? So what happens, they get the good Negroes to say, we're going to get him. He's not going to go against the grain. We're going to give him anything he wants, but we're going to keep a short leash on him. Because if he step out of line, we're going to get him.
That's why they push Shaquille O'Neal in a dress and Charles Barkley in a dress.
This is the thing about the dress thing. You can use that as comedy or whatever. I don't wear it, but you can use it as comedy. Because Flip Wilson, I grew up watching Flip Wilson in a dress. So you know what I mean? Like, listen, I used to be a kid watching Flip Wilson. But this is the thing about, I want you to understand about this whole dress thing. I know people that's gay, right? And people don't look for people that's feminine like them. They look for masculine people. My sister living in Miami, she was telling me the same thing with these dudes. Negroes are coming with Timberlands on. They're looking for dudes with Timberlands, rough dudes. Come on, D. It ain't about wearing a skirt.
Just for that, I'm going to hit the mute so I can finish reading it.
But I'm just saying, though, people tell me, again, if you choose to be that way, because wearing those things does not make you anything.
Right.
Like, just like wearing a tie. Did that tie make you smart?
Nope.
No. It's just an image, right? That's all it really is. This is the crazy part about our people. Somebody got to fix their mic. But this is the crazy part. My point of the matter, brother, rather they wear suit, ties, whatever, they always have to get the good Negroes. They cannot get the Negroes that think. They cannot get the dudes that stand on principles and morals. This is what I want you to understand. I've been in this radio game for a long time. and I've always stood on principles and morals of our people. Okay, that's it. But let me go back to that. I'm cutting this up because I don't want them to block this video, but it's on StreamYard. So bear with me, okay? I'm going to go back to the audio real fast, all right? I'm going to see if I can go through all of this. Bear with me.
Certificates would before long be of great value to industrious, well-behaved people. Let others decide whether it be legal to pass laws bearing on this subject with reference to the colored race only. End quote. Pappenheimer's proposal was nearly identical to that which Adolf Hitler enforced against Jews 30 years later. And in the same Hitlerian tone, Pappenheimer said he wanted his law to target, quote, trashy, thoughtless and shiftless Negroes,
see?
End quote. Frank's 10 black workers could aspire no higher than sweepers, haulers, elevator operators, furnace firemen, and night watchmen.
See?
Clearly, the National Pencil Company management saw itself as the industrial era's equivalent of a slave plantation. Industrialization brought with it the addition of white women and children to the ranks of the exploited. Leo Frank's white employees were paid pittance wages of about 7 to 10 cents an hour for a 55-hour work week, amounting on average to a weekly wage of just $4.05, the equivalent today of under $6,000 annually. Frank's employees often worked in appalling filth, and as testimony would later reveal, the more than 100 young Gentile girls were often subjected to sexual harassment and even molestation.
And this is why, let me stop this. You heard what he said, right? Always subjected to that. And it's still, we pick up the nasty, dirty habits of them. We pick up the same nasty, dirty habits of them. This is why I tell people, stop using also the word Gentile. Stop calling people gentlemen. That word gen is in there. Mm-hmm. Gentile.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
The Quran says, be not of the way of the jinn. The jinn, the Gentile, or gentlemen. Stop it. Everything has a vibration in it, B. Everything has a vibration. Jinn, Gentile, gentlemen. Don't ever call me a gentleman, B. Do not call me a gentleman. Okay? It tells you, be not of the way of the Gentile. And it also speaks about the jinn in the Quran. See how crazy this is? But we don't understand word. Let's go forward. Let's go.
Ooh.
As one Jewish scholar admitted, quote, Frank did hire child labor, did work at disgracefully long hours at pitifully low wages. And if he did not, as popular fancy imagined, exploit his girls sexually, he walked in on their privacy with utter contempt for their dignity. Like most factory managers of his time, he was, metaphorically at least, screwing little girls like Mary Fagan. End quote.
They got to keep this. That's Leo Frank.
Georgia alone, among all then 48 U.S. states, allowed factory owners to employ 10-year-old children and to work them 11-hour days, 6 days a week. The problem had become such a disgrace that in 1906, the Southern Rabbinical Association argued that, quote, child labor is not far removed from slave labor, end quote. When Georgians tried to address the problem with legislation, the owners of the National Pencil Company were said to have fought the measure fiercely and helped to kill it. The issue of females in the industrial workforce was also a growing concern for white Southerners. Slavery's replacement was a sharecropping system that enveloped both the black ex-slave and a fast-expanding number of poor whites. As industrialization spread, many young girls were forced into the city factories, where they worked under the unchecked control of white male managers. Their wages, meager as they were, amounted to a substantial part of Southern family income. By 1907, more than 70% of the South's female industrial workers, black and white, were under the age of 19, and they would soon make up an even larger portion of Atlanta's workforce. When Georgia politician Tom Watson spoke of female employees as being in the, quote, possession, end quote, of their factory bosses, it struck a resentful chord in Southern white males who watched helplessly as, quote, progress, end quote, lowered their women into a position no different in any discernible way from that traditionally reserved for blacks. It was commonly believed that it was impossible for a female factory worker to remain a virgin.
Damn.
One mill owner confided that, quote, To let a girl go into a cotton factory
Listen.
Was to make a prostitute of her. End quote.
Two.
And during slack seasons in the labor calendar, young women were even more vulnerable to sexual coercion. Watson spoke on behalf of this new exploitable labor pool when he described them as, quote, chattel slaves of a sordid commercialism that has no milk of human kindness in its heart of stone.
Wow.
End quote. The mood of the city and of the time is best reflected in a 1912 report by a commission established to examine the Georgia-wide commercial prostitution of white girls and women, known as, quote, white slavery, end quote. Quote, the end of the battle is not yet for those girls who struggle on alone and unprotected with their more pressing financial problems. The greatest menace before her is man. The advances of men without even a spark of bravery or honor, who hunt as their unlawful prey this impoverished girl, this defenseless child of poverty, unprotected, unloved, and uncared for, as she is plunged into the swirling, seething stream of humanity. The advances of men who are so low that they have lost even a sense of sportsmanship, and who seek as their game a tired, lonely, and destitute girl. She suffers and goes down, and is finally sacrificed to a life of shame. But what of him? He escapes. It is not just, and this type of man should be severely punished. End quote.
Yo.
Most Southerners wanted to believe that some semblance of chivalry and honor was maintained in the sprawling Atlanta factories. But the ugly fact is that the National Pencil Company was among those businesses included in the commission's grim appraisal. Be with us again next time when we present the next chapter of The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews.
So let me say this for you. This no wonder the vibration in Atlanta is the way it is. Negroes are
right.
They are playing women like a motherfucker. Grown-ass men in these strip clubs, right? Right? Probably owned by Jews, right?
Right.
Disrespected women inside these strip clubs. And y'all think it's cool because you don't know nothing about history. We don't know nothing about history.
Wow, it's the same thing going on.
Listen, I don't care. I tweeted out. They can lock my account for this motherfucker. Let's go. Be with me. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back, y'all. Let's have some fun. I'll be in ATL. I'm going to go down and do a live. Let's go.
Money. M-O-N-E.
Come on, we got to share this, baby. Let's share support. Support. Let's go. Come on. I told y'all, this wasn't prepared. This wasn't set up. I want y'all to hear something.
M-O-N-E-Y, what you need, you just get by. Money, honey, ain't it funny? Money, people want to die. It seems without money, people cry, people will lie. You cannot deny, without money, you can't apply. For anything that captures your eye, I wonder why. The root of all evil, let me teach you, now who am I? The MC, teaching my people, don't let that lie. You got to get money, but don't let money get you down. I can break it down like whatever you want. Whatever you spend your money on strong, yo, that's what you want. Spend your money on these honeys, yo, if that's what you want. Spend your money on attorneys if you're going to court. If I look around your neck, I can see what you bought. What you think, you get respect? No, you taking the short. Yo, you need the money, of course, you need it to live.
Yo, what you put your money on, Chris?
Right on my kids.
M-O-N-E-Y. Don't ask why. It is the root of all evil, though very necessary to your livelihood. It's all good when you've got enough, till enough ain't enough, and you hit upon rough times. You make your money and I'll make mine, mine, mine.
Come on, y'all, let's go.
Yeah, we need the
M-O-N-E-Y.
Don't get me wrong, mistaken this song. Like money is not important, yes it is, just be strong. It's the reason for the thieving and that war going on. It's the reason that you see
M-O-N-E-Y.
Don't get me wrong, mistaken this song. Like money is not important, yes it is, just be strong. It's the reason for the thieving and that war going on. It's the reason that you see in all these girls in the thong. It's the reason that the radio's on. It's the reason that you believe in. You gotta work from sun up till dawn. It's the cravings that connect you to that money you making. Your desire is the fire, got you feeling you slaving.
Free yourself.
Money doesn't make you the man.
Be yourself. A man gets his money and grants. Okay, I'ma get this money really all day, but not to the point where I'm going the wrong way. I'ma put my money down on rides, all that. Hook up the house so me and my spouse can fall back. Invest in my knowledge way beyond college. Write books and fly hooks in my cottage. Cheese, crisp bling bling it, yo, please. Money is an energy that gets what I need. I can understand them cats that rap flossing and fronting. It's all good, they from the hood never had nothing. They just got their money and everything sunny. Hear what I'm saying, they playing boy and looking for bunnies.
Then we lost what we bought, forgetting that sharing is what we've been taught. Cause this here getting money is an individual sport.
Come on, let's go.
Money can get me in to the same places where years ago my bros and sisters with black skin were confined to the back door and the kitchen.
Last verse, with your cash purse, reaching to your wallet, nothing a lot of that hurts. Breath stinking, you're thinking, but can't afford certs. Need the dollar and baby hollering, now work. I don't know how you gonna get the dough. You could become educated, you could become a hoe. You could do both, that's like putting butter on toast. The bread is the knowledge, butter is what gets you there close.
Money is funny, how a piece of paper can make or break your very existence. Quick as it come, quick as it go, you better know about the ebb and the flow. You get money in droves, trick it on cars and blow, throw dollars at black queens, cause for the dough, they'll strip their clothes. And for the right amount of money, a king will pimp his queen into being a hoe on a stroll. Life will always be hard when you choose to make money your God.
Mo fire.
And that's why they say the cheapest thing you can buy is a nigga and a stick of gum. Foxy, what's up? And this is why. That's all they got to do is pay these Negroes off to not tell the truth about anything. That's all they got to do. And y'all rock with that. Oh, that was fire, brother. Y'all like it because none of y'all truly want real information. So as I'm listening and studying this case, I'm studying the hell out of this case, like trying to figure it out, right? And I'm sitting here like, in order to get our people the way they get our people, how many people ever read 12 Years a Slave? How many of y'all read that book or saw the movie? I know y'all probably saw the movie, but how many of y'all read the book?
Movie.
Now, remember, I always pull these books out and show y'all this stuff, right? This is 12 Years a Slave. I compare that to going to school for 12 years, a brainwashing camp, and then 3 to 4 more years in the college for brainwashing camp, and you still don't know nothing about your history. Nothing about your history at all. But the majority of your black scholars would get on these feeds and tell you about white supremacy, slavery, emancipation, the white man's the devil. But out of all the research teams that we have, supposedly, because they get a lot of money, they don't talk about our history before the 1500s.
Nope.
But yet you got people speaking on Moors that don't understand the history of the Moors. But they're going to go to YouTube and pull stuff up on the Moors. I can pull so much information out to show y'all. So you think this is 1892. So bear with me before I play this other part. This is 1892. This book was written. So let me just take you inside this book. Give me 1 second. Somebody got their dog barking in the background. So let me just show y'all something. Bear with me 1 second, all right? Let's just go here real fast. Moorish Jews. So they're not talking about these people that y'all call Jews today. Those are Moorish Jews, right? So imagine if we was to have this dialogue. This book was written 1892. 1892. But again, your black scholars will never, ever talk about these things, okay?
No.
1892. Let's go in another part on this. And I know they're watching this video right now. Believe me, they're watching closely. But you got to come holler at Sabir to, you know, talk with me about it. This is another part. Israelitist diplomats of the Moorish Empire. Same book, 1892. Same book. So all they have done is did a bait and switch. So why are we today still calling people black and white? Why are we still talking about black and white issues? So what I'm going to do, again, when I get to Atlanta, I'm going to go to this guy's, that plaque, and I'll do a live at that plaque. If y'all want to sponsor, y'all can help me out. Do something, support, because they're asking for it on here. Look, your donation will be matched 2-1. Only 2 people hit me up. That's about it. So let's go. Let's give it up. 100, 50, 25, whatever. Let's go back to the audio, part 2 to this, okay? Hurry up. Get in where y'all fit in. Let's do part 2.
The Atlanta press presses for answers. Within the trial of Leo Frank. Quote, their defense of Frank was largely an asserting of his and, by extension, their own whiteness. End quote.
Oh, so let me go up.
Dr. Stuart Rockoff. The Frank Conley stare down. Frank blinks. The pure uniqueness of the Conley-Frank courtroom drama must be viewed in full American racial context. In the post-slavery South, a black man, woman, or child who talked back to a white man was considered suicidal. A black man accusing a white man of any crime, much less that of murder, was uncharted racial territory. Not uncharted in terms of whether he would face a public execution. That was assured. Just how many of the man's family, friends, and neighbors might be collaterally slaughtered was the only unknown in the equation. Collective punishments, including wholesale massacres of blacks for the slightest perceived offenses, had become part and parcel of American race relations. In 1955, more than 4 decades after Mary Fagan's murder, a black man named Mose Wright stood in a Mississippi court, and when asked to identify the white man he saw kidnap his murdered nephew, Emmett Till, he pointed to the white man and said, in common black country vernacular, quote, dar he, end quote. There he is. For that simple testimony, the 64-year-old Wright had to instantaneously leave Mississippi for good. Historian W. Fitzhugh Brundage reports that 1/4 of Georgia's reported mass mob lynchings involved, quote, torture, mutilation, and grisly ceremonies, end quote. None of the black victims of this gruesome system of white justice had even been charged with the acts that James Conley was now openly admitting to. Further, it was considered racial heresy for a white man to allow such black insolence to go unpunished, in that it was feared that such a display of black boldness would threaten the entire superstructure of white supremacy. Such a black man had to be forcibly put down, lest he, quote, infect with his audacity, end quote, everyone else's, quote, Negro property, end quote. All whites lived by this code without exception. And blacks, of course, had no option but to abide. But when Leo Frank was given the responsibility of confronting Conley face to face in the presence of white men of standing, Frank declined, claiming instead that he needed a specific one of his many lawyers to be present, who was then out of town. But attorney Luther Rosser soon returned, and Frank still avoided the head-to-head with Conley. American courtroom procedures have evolved in some respects since the 1910s, but in 1913, the age-old right to face one's accuser had not yet been confined to a courtroom procedure. And in the Southern society in which Frank lived and thrived, this kind of extrajudicial confrontation was as common as an arraignment is today. Chief of Detectives Newport A. Lanford made every attempt to arrange a Conley-Frank encounter in the presence of the grand jury. Not in the police station, the jail, or any environment to which Leo Frank might object. But according to the Constitution, quote, when word came to, end quote, Frank, quote, that the police chiefs and the Pinkerton man desire to confront him with Conley. The prisoner positively refused them an audience, end quote. His refusal to confront Conley amounted to sacrilege, a grievous offense. And for many Georgians, it was akin to a guilty plea. For his part, the Negro, James Conley.
We're going to stop this for a second, right? So I'm bear with me 1 second, okay, y'all? So
yeah.
This is the crazy part, right? To understand all of this, we don't even have our own people on our own panel, right? Mm-hmm. If we had a jury of our peers, right, for the record, that's why it's important for us to understand the Constitution. A jury of your peers are people who are like you. That's a peer. Or now they call them character witnesses. See how law comes directly back into this again? Mm-hmm. So they bring people called character witnesses. I don't know if you'll know that or not. So a character witness is someone that knows your character, right? Somebody that knows you. That's what a character witness is, right? When we go into the jury, because we don't understand jury or jury nullification, none of these things, because these things are not being taught by our people. The elite people that's in these colleges are not going to talk about these things. They're not going to tell you. They're going to tell you how many thousands of dollars you have. How many thousands of dollars you have? 0, 2, 3, 1. Give me 1 second. 0, 3, 2, 1. Bear with me. My feeds are open, y'all. 0, 3, 2, 1.
Was it? Come get this work.
Hold up. Give me 1 second. I'm trying to pull something up so y'all can see this. 0, 3, 0, 3. I want to pull something up. Give me 1 second. 0, 3. I got to do it again. Bear with me 1 second. I got to pull this out one more time. I'm going to explain something to y'all to show you what even Franz Fanon was talking about with our people. And this is what is happening with a lot of your so-called celebrities out here. It's not white supremacy, people. And who created that white supremacy concept? 0, 2, 3, 1. 0, 2, 3, 1. Give me 1 second. So bear with me. So if anyone who ever read Franz Fanon's work, and I've been saying this for the longest, right? It's not white supremacy, it's systematic. Systematic, right? Not white supremacy, because nobody's white and nobody's black. That's a fact. It's a fact. Right. Nobody's white and nobody's black. But if I could convince you that you are that, then I got you. Right? So bear with me. This is exactly what's going on right now. Bear with me 1 second. So this is Franz Fanon's work. If you're not familiar with it, you see what it says about the inferiority of the black man. And many books speaks about this. Many books. Carter G. Woodson, Franz Fanon. This is on page 9 of Black Skin, White Mass. Said everybody should have this book, Black Skin, White Mass. He said the inferiority. The African today is the inferiority of the black man, especially evident in the educated black man. I can't make this up. Wearing of the European's clothes, rather they are rags or the most up-to-date style, using the European furniture. Come on, B. Y'all know this is true. Y'all know that's true.
So, greetings. Are you hearing me?
Peace. Yes, sir. I can hear you loud and clear.
Yes, greetings. I have a question. I have a couple of questions here. One is with the West Semitic Jews, where does their origin stem from?
Them?
Their origin.
Polish or Germans?
All right, but they take it from the word Shem. That is the three sons of Noah, which is Ham, Shem, and Japheth.
Yeah.
Okay.
But they stole the thing from us.
Okay, if they are the three could a woman, because as according to the book, that's what the book says, right? The book says that Noah was pure in his generation. So could a woman, did the woman make the three boys, which is Ham, Shem, and Japheth, were they, as it is known, or as it is said, I'm seeing what is being said, that Ham looks dark. He was the darker race, right? And Shem, which they are taking it from, that is the color, the skin color, now, that they look the way they look. And Japheth, how he would have looked, well, they give no description. And these three boys were born at the same time. So how, that is why I'm asking, where is the origin, if they're taking it from Shem, from the Shemites, from that foundation?
But that's what they're saying, right? But let me just use me, right? Mm-hmm. My mother have nine of us, right? Nine of us. Each and every last one of us. If you see my sister, you would think she's Caucasian. I'm going to be real with you. She looks like it. See that light?
No problem.
It's only, hear me out. Mm-hmm. We have different shades in my family, darker than you. My father's by your complexion. I have a sister that's darker than you. I have me, I'm light as hell. My sister's lighter than me. So each and every last one of us have different complexions. So I don't even know sometimes where these stories half the time come from, but they still family.
Yes.
Yeah. Family, regardless, but there is an origin from which some come from. Every last one of these people are coming directly from us, but all they have done is switch. Or again, the age, it's the language also.
When the main thing right there is the language because what I'm looking at is because these three boys were triplets.
See what I'm saying?
I am saying what the book says. I'm not a Bible person, but I'm just saying what the book says. The book says that Noah was 500 years old when he had these three boys, and you could only be 500 years once in your lifetime. So these boys were triplets.
Exactly. But hold on. Let me tell you
about this. So how we look, they look how they look. If that is their origin. They are converts.
Converts. But they still with family.
And because of the language, because of the language, they look, you see, and you cannot give them wrong either for claiming the language, because if you don't claim it and somebody has claimed the language, you can't say anything. They have claim on the language, that they know the language better than you. That's what they are saying. That is the only thing that they have is the language, but they are converts. But if you do not know that, you know, they keep running and then they have these, now, the word Jews, if you get an older Bible, the older King James, you will find the first time the word Jews is being mentioned in the old King James Bible is 2 Chronicles 16, verse 6, and they are with you at war. That is an absolute fact. Now, in these new versions, now they change the word from Jews to Judah.
Yep.
Judah in there now. But if you look at the older King James Bible, you'll find the word Jews is being mentioned there. And it was not referring to the people who call themselves Jews, as it is said in Revelation.
Exactly.
The people who call themselves Jews, those are the people that Revelation is talking about. And those are the people.
I did a video on that whole subject, brother, from Ethiopia on down. I did a couple of videos on YouTube, and I explained this to people. So when I'm looking at with our people here, what they, because of the education, because they're not being taught this. Honestly, they're true. We, and a lot of these black scholars are not teaching our people these things. And if you go back to the origins, one of the greatest books that I tell people to pick up is this also. This book right here. I don't know what country you're in, brother, but this book.
This country here, I was in a show. This country here is Kairi. That's the indigenous name. That's how we call it, and that's how it stays. But the corporation name, Kairi, K-A-I-R-I. It means the spirit of the bird. But the corporation who is doing business on our land is the corporation called the Government of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago.
Oh, Trinidad, Trinity, baby. Yes, you know, because even that word Trinidad means Trinity. That's
yeah.
What Trinidad means. It means Trinity.
That is the three pyramids it has here. There are pyramids on this land. And those pyramids were built before 1492. There are pyramids on this land. Huge, huge, huge pyramids.
You see what I'm saying?
And those are ours.
Everything nope. happened after 1492. I keep trying to tell people that. And if we study the history of the Moors, and when I was in Granada, Spain, dude never ever came to the United States before. It was a Muslim brother pulled me to the side and said, you know there's pyramids in Cuba. This is what he said, because they was there. But if you study the history, that's why I said our history here, brother, it don't go beyond 1600s. Majority of our scholars here do not study history before the 1600s, bro. And that's what Carter G. Woodson was saying about black scholars. He said black scholars know nothing about history prior to their enslavement. Prior to their enslavement, they know nothing about history. And I can show you the book that he talked about. Carter G. Woodson, give me one second.
No problem.
So, Carter G. Woodson wrote this in his book about black scholars. Negroes, why are we talking about him? Why are we talking about Carter G. Woodson, who started Negro Week? He said, blacks, he said, scholars know nothing about history prior to their enslavement. And he talked about that we care less. I did a video on this the other day. Most historians practically know nothing about nothing about the Negroes in Africa prior to their enslavement. And there's little systematic effort to study them. That's what he said. Little systematic to study them. So if we don't, we're not even talking about him.
Yes.
About him.
Yeah.
We don't want this conversation.
Yeah.
Right? So I could talk about the pyramids here, but the thing about it though, me, when I travel, I try to bring what's over there over here too.
Yeah.
That's
you make the link. You make the link.
Yeah, you're making the link, right? So
yes.
I'm gonna pull something else for you, brother. Bear with me. I'm gonna pull something else. I was trying to find this book when I was in Spain. This particular book right here. I'm gonna pull this book up so you can see this. Yeah, I was like going all, I was on every cab, like buses, trying to find this particular book in Spain. But I'm gonna show you this book.
If I it's in Spanish,
it's in Spanish, but I can't even find the book. I can't even find the book. I bought books in Spain that is actually Spanish too. I got books over there. Hold up. Let me pull this book up real fast. This book right here. Right? So give me one second.
No
this
problem.
Book right here. I was trying to find over there. This book right here. Africa versus America. That book right there. I was trying to find that.
I'm seeing it. Even the word Africa is a recent word calling that land Africa. Africa comes from it's an Arabic word that means separate, Faraka.
Well, it's from Tunis. It's the Tunisian word. It's from Africa. It's from Africa. Right. I did a video on that too. But this particular book, I was trying to find that book right there. And I had to research her because she was an heirs, right? And when I was over there trying to get this book, I was like, yo, I'm searching, big, trying to find this book. But nobody had the book. But I'm going to show you who she is, and I'm going to show you some other stuff. Bear with me. And if we really had these types of conversations, it would be cool. Someone's mic is causing interference. Okay, my brother, it might be my brother's mic that's on here. Right. Trinidad. Just mute your mic for a second. Yeah, just mute your mic for one second.
No problem.
So this is another book. This is the lady right here. That's the lady. She was an heiress who wrote the book, and she found paperwork on the history, right, of Spain and Africa, Spain and America, right? Her. But this is some other books that was bought from Spain. Let me show y'all something. This is from Spain, all in Spanish. All in Spanish. Right? Negro. So Negro is Spanish, right? Nigga is Latin, black is English. So all this is in Spanish, right? This is in Spanish.
Truth. Yes, truth.
You follow me? So it's not like, you know, the stuff is hidden from us. It's just that we don't have enough people really behind the real people who actually do the research. You know, because a lot of stuff, we can have these conversations on any platform.
Like when I call yourself black, it's really a color. You are pulling all the negative energies because black, you're not even calling yourself somebody. Black is not a noun. A noun is the name of a person. A noun is a person, a place, or a thing. So you're actually calling yourself an adjective. You're describing yourself. As I just said before, you're not black, you're not white. You're all in negative. The worst thing to do is to call yourself black. That's the only worst thing you could do. Because all the negative energy you pulling on yourself. And that is hence the reason why black people are treated the way they are treated.
Thank you. You see what I'm saying? I'm not saying that. Trinidad is saying that. And we're going to keep holding on to this, brother, and trying to look for justice. Let me help you out, brother. Since you said that, let me take you to J.A. Rogers real fast. Can you see what I posted where it says black and colored like white, on the other hand, has no historical meanings whatsoever for African people? Black is from the Anglo-Saxon B-L-A-E-C.
It means pale. It means pale.
So, how is you it? Are not- I can show you this, and we go right back to sleep with this game coming again. Nate, 180 facts about the Negro.
And to prove how that is true, in order for us to communicate the way we are doing now, we communicate in a language. The science of communication, of communicating the way we do now, is language. And the science of language is words. Words have power, energy, vibration, color, weight. Words is everything. When you use the right word, you get the right result because you're using the right word. When you use the wrong word, you get the wrong result. Hence the reason why when you use words like black, you're in trouble before you start, and black has no standing at law. That's it. Hence the reason when I enter the courtroom, you lose before you start because you're black. You could do what they want. You could do what they want. They could do what they want.
So here's another one from J.A. Rogers.
To identify as black, you're in trouble.
Let me mute your mic 1 second, brother, because they say the same exact. Let me read this to you.
Yeah.
The most ancient names for so-called black people are Nehesu, Nasu, or Nubian, Ethiopian, or Moors from ancient Egypt. That's the top. Moors from ancient Egypt. It didn't say Morocco, right? But it goes down here. It says black and colored like white. On the other hand, European words, not the white man's words. Ethiopian and Moor was probably used to describe the so-called blacks until the 1500s. So why are we rejecting this? And why are your black scholars rejecting this information? I hope y'all share this out to them. I would love to sit with them and ask them, why are they rejecting that? Why are they ignoring that? They only switch places with you, bro. Like that movie Trading Places.
Truly, truly. You see how you broke down gentleman or gentleman and what the word means? That is what you have to do with every word in order to see what the word is. It's like how some people use the word belief. Because belief has lie in it. And it's either you know or you don't know. But you put belief inside there with a lie in the word itself. So the word tells you exactly what it is.
Yep. Hey, listen.
It's like poly. Poly means many, and tick is a blood-sucking parasite. That is politics. It tells you what it is. So it's not only politician, it's on you. Govern means to control, and meant is mentality. Mental. So if you allow these blood-sucking parasites to control your mind, as the word says what it is, you cannot blame anybody. It's all plain on word. You say it all the time. I hear you saying it all the time. This is the word game. is words of the limit. I'm going to break the word down. You could be them on their own word. Like they have a thing in the court, they say maintenance, right? But what is maintenance? They have to explain what is maintenance because they have a they will have something called they will have what it is maintenance mean. To you it means something else, but you know what maintenance is. So it has to be broken down for you to really understand or understand what it is they mean when they say maintenance. What they really mean is a salary.
Let me move forward, brother. I don't mean to cut you wisdom, but let me move forward because I want to get off here in a second.
No problem. Yeah.
I want to read something to y'all, and I'm sharing these books because I want y'all, and I thank you so much. But I want to show you something on this book. And also, this book y'all should have also before the Mayflower. You should have this book before the Mayflower too. So, in this book right here, right, it talks about the first blacks were called blackamoors. Like I said, the black was an adjective, and more, niggers. The word Negro is Spanish or Portuguese. The term black did not come into the general use in Virginia until what? The latter part of the century. So it's all new. It's new. So if you get a chance, if you can find it, call my brother Yoel at the Underground Bookstore. I'm going to give you his number. Call him. He may still have the soft copies of this particular book. So I'm going to give you my brother Yoel's phone number, and y'all can call him. And see, let's see. And you can go to my website too. His link is on my website, Sabir Bay. It says Sabir Bay Merchandise.squarespace.com. But I'll give you the phone number so you can call in 768-8869. That's the bookstore number right here. Give him a call right now. Underground, he ships everywhere. So if you're on Saturn, he'll ship to Saturn too. Your phone is acting up, brother, so you got to mute your mic.
All right, I want to say one thing before I...
Go ahead. Unmute your mic.
Unmute. Okay, are you hearing me now?
Yeah, we can hear you.
I'm saying that I'm going now, but you are doing such an excellent job. Such good work that you are doing. There are a lot of teachers that is teaching on the World Wide Web now. And everybody is taking it from a different angle. And everybody have their own unique space that when you listen and you look at it, you see how everything is fitting. And you have your unique space that you have the receipts and you are showing it. Nobody's doing it like you. You are actually showing it.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate
you. Your space is unique. Unique, and you know, everybody. I take a look at everybody, you know, your name has been mentioned because not only there are other people who are only what happens to like in your case, you will not find much time looking at other people's platform, right? So we could kind of like and say, yes, this is really it. There ain't no stopping us now. Excellent work.
Hold on. It's funny that you said that, right? Hold up. You funny, dude. You just said that. Hey, I see my brother. What you call y'all kind of quiet over there now. I see my brother Romeo. They kind of quiet. So, brother, I thank you so much. And you ain't never lie about that. He said, ain't no stopping us now on this thing, baby.
No time.
Stopping us now.
No. Be on the move. Be on the move.
Can't stop a stepper.
Hey, man. So please, people, like, support, and share. I agree. Out of here. Like, support, and people, share.
One more thing. One more. People should know that this is the best time to be alive is now. It's now.
Right. It's a great time to be alive. Great time to be alive.
Always now. You have no past. No time is an ever-present reality that knows no past, no future. So the best time to be alive and happy is now. It is.
I thank you, brother. I want to thank Stan, my brother Romeo, my brother Ephraim. I want to thank y'all for joining me. I want to thank y'all, the audience. Please share these videos out. And shout out to my sister Sonia in the UK. Shout out to Sonia Foxy. Thank y'all so much, man. But I do got to go and take care of some stuff. But please tweet these videos out. Again, you will know when I'm in Atlanta when I get there. you will know when I get there. So hit the like button, hit the support button, and I got to close out with my brother because he said ain't no stopping us now. So let's go.
Really, appreciate baby. You, beloved.
Philly, baby. Ain't no stopping us, baby. If they block us, we on StreamYard. Just like this. Just this way, like this. Bring it in. Phillies, baby. It's the Philly Fest.
There's been so many things that's held us down, but now it looks like things are finally coming around. I know we've got a long, long way to go, and where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing
hold us back. Baby.
We're putting ourselves together, we're polishing up our actions. If you've ever been held down before, I know you refuse to be held down anymore. Well,
don't you let nothing, nothing stand in your way.
Peace, Tony B. Tony B. Conscious. Margaret, see you soon.
I know you know someone that has a negative vibe, and if they're trying to make it, they only push you aside. They really don't have nowhere to go.
Ask them where they're going, and they don't know.
Ask them where they're going, they don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're gonna put our show together. Gonna polish up.